Alright, this is my tutorial for my replica of the Bell X-1 for Realism Overhaul Career. When you start out, it will be on the runway, but if you are launching, if you are doing the final launch, you want to make sure your crew, you want to make sure your crew member has a parachute, and you want to set it up for an air launch. In the simulation, you can set up an air launch basically whenever you like, but for the actual flight, you have to set this up at the time. These are my recommended settings. It points you towards the space center. It gets you as high and fast as you can from the first level of air launch. And it gives you enough distance from the space center that you will be approaching the space center by the time you run out of fuel, by the time your supersonic flight is over. So, as soon as we get air launched, in a normal flight, there will be a bit of a countdown before the air launch, unless they've changed that recently, unless they've changed that very recently, but, there will be a countdown, you will be teleported to the air launch location, and your speed will be set, and the game will take a moment to update. During that update, you press P to turn on aircraft autopilot. Also worth noting, I have pressed Y to activate nav HUD. So let's go. I'm pressing P to activate aircraft autopilot. That will keep the plane stable and stop it from nosing down, which it will by its if you leave it to its own devices at this point. So, we throttle up, engine ignition. And we are actually pressing caps lock to activate fine control. That stops you from making excessively, well, it stops you making from excess from making excessive movements. Especially important for roll control. You really need fine control to control your rolling properly. So I have nosed up to that marker on nav HUD, which is 15 degrees, almost 15 degrees on the nav ball. I think it might be about 12 degrees actually. I don't know how. Wait, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Wait. 6, 7. That's weird. There's 7 divisions. There are 7 vertical divisions, so this isn't a precise number, but it's a little under 15 degrees. And we stay here for a little while actually. We stay flying at this in this direction and with this full throttle for a little while, basically until we get to 12 kilometers. So we can time warp a little. I'm not time warping all the way because sometimes the craft does nose down of its own accord. That just happens when you time warp with planes in Realism Overhaul with aircraft autopilot. Yeah, you saw that movement. I didn't do that. That was the vehicle working on its own. So we are approaching 12 kilometers. Now we want to start nosing down, and we want to watch the green marker for our direction. We want to watch the prograde marker, and have it being about level to the horizon when we reach about 12.5 kilometers. Exactly how high you go will depend on what mission objectives you are trying to create. This thing can reach 15 kilometers with ease. The fastest I've managed to go with it is about 565 meters per second at 15 kilometers altitude. You may be able to get to 600 meters per second, it depends. For this flight, we're trying to maximize time spent at over 350 meters per second, but below 400 meters per second. So when we reach about 370 meters per second, we throttle down until one thrust chamber shuts down. That is a really cool feature, actually, that Realism Overhaul. Oh, we need to throttle down again, actually, until two thrust chambers shut down, and we want to be staying around 12,500 meters. So this is the way the rocket engine throttled in real life. Each chamber always operates at full throttle, but any individual chamber can be shut down. Yes. So this keeps us flying for quite a while. You can get about 5 minutes of your supersonic flight flight experiment with each flight, which means you need about 5 flights to get the whole thing, in general. That is assuming that all 5 flights are doing this and trying to keep velocity between about 350 and 400. I tend to keep it between 350 and 375, and as you can see, you have a lot of control over this. The actual throttle behavior of this engine does work the way it would in real life, where you are either at 100% throttle, 75% throttle, 50% throttle, 25% throttle, or 0% throttle, and I am quite impressed that the Realism Overhaul team have added that, actually. It's an extremely good behavior that I am pleased about. And as you can see, you have fairly fine control over your velocity. Well, over your acceleration. There's not that much difference between shutting one chamber down versus shutting two chambers down. And of course, MechJeb assumes you're operating at full throttle. We're not operating at full throttle, so we have more time than this. It did take us several minutes to get up to altitude and up to speed, but losing my train of thought a little there. It did take us several minutes to get up to altitude and up to speed, but now that we're up to speed and up to altitude, we can maintain this speed for a long time. And over in the distance, we're starting to see the coastline. It's okay if you can't tell between the coastline and the clouds. My cursor isn't being picked up, but basically right above the tip of the stabilizer is the coastline. Right when I was saying that is. So we're going to continue flying here, and then I'll show you how to land this thing. The real X-1 landed on the extremely flat desert. It was not launched from Cape Canaveral either, it was launched over land. But I'm going to show you how to land it on the runway. Cape Canaveral does have the Space Shuttle runway, and we're going to be using that. I have not successfully landed the X-1 on the regular 2 kilometer KSC runway. However, you can land it on that. I'm fairly sure the slowdown, if you get a good approach velocity, the slowdown distance is a little over a kilometer, so you can land it on the main regular runway, but we drop below 350. Supersonic science only requires you to be at 300 or above, and it requires you to be above 10 kilometers. I like to keep the plane flying at over 350 meters per second, generally. You can slow it down and fly for longer, but supersonic flight science, it requires a hidden resource, and you can only run it for 8 minutes at most on a single flight. Throttling down again. But yes, I'm going to show you how to land the plane on the runway, because Kerbal Space Program's terrain is not exactly great for landing something like this. We are going to start pitching down a little as well. Just a little. We're pointing, we're facing horizontal, so we're starting to dip a little bit below the horizontal. Throttling up again. We've almost reached burnout time. Now, the engine has been running for more than the 5 minutes that it's supposed to, but, like, we've been running at lower throttle, which means it's fine. throttling down again. And this last throttle down should take us to the end of the supersonic flight scheme. We will burn through the rest of our fuel here. And there we go. So now we can pitch down. And I can see where the runway is. I don't know if you can necessarily see where it is. So if you look right above the vertical stabilizer, it's about there. I wish I could capture my cursor, but alas, we shall deal with what we can deal with. So, I'm tilting. I've rolled a little to the left, just to turn a bit, because we want to be heading a little to the south, but not very much to the south. And roughly about here, I'm going to turn back. So now we are at zero roll, or near, or thereabouts. Yeah. So now we just fly down, pretty much, down towards the coastline. You can probably see the runway a lot better now. It's yeah, about where the vertical stabilizer is. Ignore the glitchy ocean, if you can possibly ignore it. So the X-1 is, because it is straight-winged, it is not actually very good at flying supersonic. We're starting to pull up here, also, and I'm going to switch to altitude above ground, because that's more useful for landing. So the X-1 isn't especially good at flying supersonic. It requires quite high thrust away to quite high altitude in order to break the sound barrier. But the benefit that it does have is that it's very good at gliding, so we don't actually have too much trouble with landing. Well, we don't have too much trouble with landing as far as slowing down before landing. As far as slowing down too much before landing is a problem with some swept-wing planes. The problem we do have with the X-1 is we need to slow down to about 100 meters per second by the time we hit the runway. And now that the runway is so above the spike, about right where the spike is pointing, you can almost certainly see it by now. Now that the runway is about there and is about vertical in our relative vision, from this perspective, we're going to start turning. And we turn further than the runway, further than we need to in order to be pointing at the runway. Now, just to indicate where the runway is, the prograde marker is on the end of the runway. But we're going to keep turning. We're going to keep doing these. We're going to keep doing these turns, and that's necessary to slow down. You can slow down quite a lot with this vehicle. It's not the most maneuverable, but it's maneuverable enough for doing this. Yeah. This is just to bleed off velocity. And as I said, this thing is a surprisingly good glider. It is very easy to fly. I am not someone who is good at flying planes, but I find this thing easy to fly. I'm just going to do a little bit more of this maneuvering. We do want to avoid flying too far off course as well, because we do want to be approaching the runway approximately straight. Alright, we're at 130-ish meters flying above the regular space center. As I said, you can land on this runway if you are a good pilot, and if you are experienced enough. So now that we're dropping down to 115, 110, we're going to level out a little bit. We do need to actually do a little bit more curving, and we're dropping the gear right now. Turning the lights off because I prefer not to have them on when landing in the day, and I only land in the day. We are actually going a bit too fast still, so I'm going to do a few more turns. You can see how little velocity we lost when we were at like very little roll. Yeah, we're at about the velocity we need to be for this approach. You should when you're flying this, you should adjust the amount of bleeding off speed. You should just adjust the amount which you bleed off speed in order to account for how fast you're approaching. 110 meters per second is fine for an approach. Like, it's okay. It's not optimal, but it's something you can work with. If you were going at 130, that would be too much. Now, I did say, I believe, that when you set up the real flight, you should make sure your crew member has a parachute. You can do this when selecting crew for the vehicle. So, we're trying to land as close to horizontal as we can, and there we go. Now we're on the ground, we can hit the brakes. But as I was saying, you should make sure that. Oh, hang on. That's a problem. We lost the engine. We did tail strike. We did tail strike. But we still landed. Even if you get a tail strike, you can still recover. Practice with this several times before you get a flight. But and also make sure your Kerbal has a parachute. There is an eject button, and it is also automatically tied to the abort action group. So if your plane is crashing, you can eject. Though don't do so too close to the ground, because if you do, then your crew member's parachute doesn't have time to unfurl. But that is how to fly the X-1 and how to. I was nosing down to recover from that landing after the tail strike. I was nosing down quite hard. That's how to fly the X-1. And that's why you don't want to come down faster than 100 meters per second, because it can be a bit harder to control. But there we go. That's how you fly my X-1.